Mr. Chairman, Director, thank you for your service to the country, and I do appreciate your acknowledgement and that of my colleagues of the difficulty in reconciling competing binary constitutional principles like public safety, national security, and privacy. And I confess up front my bias is towards public safety. Because of this loosely held conviction I have that the right to counsel, the right to free speech, the right to a jury trial just isn't of much use if you're dead. So I reconcile those competing principles in favor of public safety. And my concern, as I hear you testify, is that I have colleagues and others who are advocating for these evidence-free zones. They're just going to be compartments of life where you are precluded from going to find evidence of anything. And I'm trying to determine whether or not we as a society are going to accept that, that there are certain, no matter how compelling the government's interest is in accessing that evidence, we are declaring right now this is an evidence-free zone. You can't go here no matter whether it's a terrorist plot. Now, I'm not talking about the Fiend case. That's a drug case. The case the magistrate decided yesterday in New York is a drug case. Those are a dime a dozen. National security? There's nothing that the government has a more compelling interest in than that, and we're going to create evidence-free zones? Am I missing something? Is that how you see it, that you just can't go in these categories unless somebody consents?
That's my worry and why I think it's so important we have this conversation, because even I, on the surface, think it sounds great when people say, hey, you buy this device, no one will ever be able to look at your stuff. But there are times when law enforcement saves our lives, rescues our children, and rescues our neighborhoods by going to a judge and getting permission to look at our stuff. And so, again, I come to the case of the Baton Rouge 8-month pregnant woman shot when she opens her door. Her mom says she keeps a diary on her phone. We can't look at the diary to figure out what might have been going on in her life. Who is she texting with? That's a problem. I love privacy. All of us also love public safety. And it's so easy to talk about, buy this amazing device, you'll be private. But you have to take the time to think, okay, there's that, and what are the costs of that? And that's where this collision's coming in.
Well, I love privacy too, but I want my fellow citizens to understand that most of us also, in varying degrees, also love our bodies and the physical integrity of our body. But since Schmerber, the government has been able to access orders for either blood against the will of the defendant, or in some instances, surgical procedures against the will of the defendant. So when I hear my colleagues say, have you ever asked a non-government actor to participate in the securing of evidence? Absolutely. That's what the surgeon does. If you have a bullet from an officer who was shot in a defendant, you can go to a judge and ask the judge to force a nurse or surgeon to anesthetize and remove that bullet. So if you can penetrate the integrity of the human body in certain categories of cases, how in the hell you can't access a phone? I just find baffling. But let me ask you this. If Apple were here, and they're going to be here, how would they tell you to do it? If there were a plot on an iPhone to commit an act of violence against, hey, say, hypothetically, an Apple facility, and they expected you to prevent it, how would they tell you to access the material on this phone?
I think they would say what they've said, which I believe is in good faith, that we have designed this in response to what we believe to be the demands of our customers to be immune to any government warrant or the manufacturer's efforts to get in that phone. We think that's what people want. And that may be so, except I would hope folks will look at this conversation and say, really, do I want that? And take a step back and understand that this entire country of ours is based on a balance. It's a hard one to strike, but it's so seductive to talk about privacy is the ultimate value in a society where we aspire to be safe and have our families safe and our children safe. That can't be true. We have to find a way to accommodate both.
So Apple, on the one hand, wants us to kind of weigh and balance privacy, except they've done it for us. They have said, at least as it relates to this phone, we've already done that weighing and balancing, and there is no governmental interest compelling enough for us to allow you to try to guess the password of a dead person's phone that is owned by a city government. There's no balancing to be done. They've already done it for us. I would just tell you, Director, in conclusion, we asked the Bureau and others to do a lot of things. Investigate crime after it's taken place, anticipate crime, stop it before it happens. And all you're asking is to be able to guess the password and not have the phone self-destruct. And you can go into people's bodies and remove bullets, but you can't go into a dead person's iPhone and remove data. I just find it baffling.